All right. Well, thanks everybody for joining in today. Hopefully we'll make it a fun-filled adventure for you. So typical topic for us, Hacking Exposed Live. We're, of course, the bravest or the dumbest in trying to do a lot of these demos all live because you never quite know what's going to happen, but we're going to give it a go. And hopefully you can coax us along a bit. I usually label it pretty generically, next generation threats or something of that nature, simply because, quite honestly, it's very difficult to predict the latest and greatest threats out there, and we want to be very, very topical and timely with regard to content. But we also have heard a lot about this sophisticated attacks verbiage out there, and I want to kind of debunk that a bit. So let me walk you through it, and then we'll kind of get started on the demos as fast as we can. So some of the biggest myths running out there is it's all new, it's all sophisticated, totally advanced, no one's ever seen this stuff before. That's probably the biggest myth that's running out there today. And I'm going to hopefully expose that a little bit. The other one is the defender's dilemma. Now, we've all been trained to believe that, and in large part it's true, but not to the degree at which people want you to believe. So the defender's dilemma is really simple, that the adversary only needs one way in to your network and your asset, whereas the defender has to defend and prevent endless 100% of all surface area of the attack. Well, that by its nature, at least philosophically, is true. But practically what happens is people give up on prevention. And that's just the wrong way to go because nothing is new. And nothing is sophisticated. We'll see maybe one every 5 to 10 years that just has any inkling of a sophistication, something like the DDR3 bit overlap vulnerability that just came out in early March. Okay, that's unique. That's interesting. It's sophisticated. But we still haven't seen any POCs out of it. We were working on one, scrambling one for this one. Couldn't quite get it perfect. So it's really mostly myth. The other myth that you'll hear a lot is 60% of all attacks don't use malware. And that's just fraught with all kinds of flawed kind of myth components. So first of all, anything that's malware, we consider anything malicious software. So if it can run on an endpoint, if it can execute in an interpret environment, in binary code, in anything, to us, absolutely it's considered malware. Authentication-based and insider threat attacks certainly happen all by themselves, but eventually, somebody has to use something somewhere along the way to help exfiltrate data, to help override a hard disk, to do something that is considered bad, which, of course, includes that. And then complete in-memory attacks, absolutely, those can happen. Again, very small percentage, but absolutely, eventually, something has to execute somewhere in memory that can be looked at and determined either good or bad. Last myth, which I kind of teed up, was prevention is just not possible. If you've subscribed to this, don't feel bad. Hopefully I'm going to change your mind, okay? Prevention is very much possible. And you just can't give up on it, and you can't drink the Kool-Aid of the industry trying to tell you that. It's just simply not true. And you don't necessarily need products to do it either. So let's just see what all this means. So here's a quick agenda. I'm going to run through all of these, hopefully, in our 50-minute period. First one, for those that haven't seen it, I'm actually going to demonstrate how the Sony malware kind of worked and talk a little bit about some of the nuances there. So we're going to set that up really quickly. It takes about 45 seconds or so to actually work. So we're going to kind of let that go, and we're going to jump right into Operation Cleaver. Just a quick survey. Has anybody heard of the Operation Cleaver that we released in December of this year? Last year, rather? Okay. So not too many. So what we're going to do is actually walk you through live how the Iranians hacked into global critical infrastructure. And we're able to gain very deep access into sensitive networks and systems out there to the point where I got worried. And I just said, we've got to release this stuff as quick as possible. We're going to show you a couple of forever days. These are my favorite. They yell at us when we drop O days at these things now. But I can at least drop forever days. Okay, these are features inside of operating systems and applications that you can use maliciously and that are basically going to go nowhere. And then lastly, we'll find out the results of the Sony stuff. So throughout that, we're going to talk about mitigations and prevention and go on our way. Okay, so the Sony malware, there was two big parts, maybe more, two primary parts. One was a rat kind of component called Destover. Another one was the wiper type of technology. And that's what I'm going to show you here today. So first of all, the wiper hash that I'm going to use here starts with a 201A. Okay, now this is just the SHA-256 of the hash. And I'm going to run this. But it has a number of sleep functions actually in it, the longest one of which is 2.7 million. Now, these are milliseconds, of course, so that's 2,700 seconds, which is, any guesses? Any smart mathematicians out there? How many minutes is that? I kind of teed it up before. 45 minutes. So now, why would malware writer put in a sleep time so it just sits there and sleeps for 45 minutes? Any ideas? So I heard sandbox. Was it somewhere over here? Yeah, that's in large part one of the biggest ways around kind of common sandboxes. Now, there are some sophisticated ways to prevent that and actually get to basically bypass the sleeping, which I'm going to show you in a little bit. But that's in large part why malware writers do that, or to coordinate a timing scenario of some sort. So that's 45 minutes. So let's go ahead and start the malware. So I have a system here. And this is just a clean system with nothing else running on it. And basically, that's what the victims had on their box, was basically nothing running on it because nothing was preventing it. So if we take a look at this file, wait, before I jump in there, I want to show you it here. So I've queried it on Virus Total Intelligence. You can see the file right here, 201A. If I mouse over, of course, I get my JavaScript that some works. Sometimes, there we go. And you can see now all of the AV engines that detect this. It's either Wiper or it's Destover or some kind of variant therein. But here's the most interesting part, is if you go into this actual analysis, and of course it historically records everything, you can go backwards in time and say, okay, well, when was this actually known in the industry? So let's just go backwards. Here we go. So the very first instance of this particular sample in VirusTotal, so you could claim the public domain, was December 3rd. Now, if you remember, they got hit on 11/24. And at that time, only three vendors saw it as bad, at least at December 3rd. Now, on November 24th, we don't know, really. But we do know that McAfee was over at Sony, was a part of their protection. And of course, they worked with Microsoft. So it makes sense that those three would have the first publicly available kind of signatures, but who do you think had a signature or a prevention capability for it back then? Like no AV, like zero, right? That's why it worked. So just remember that date real quickly, okay? So 12/3. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that very sample. I've made it live by calling it executable. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to run it. Now, like I said, this takes about 45 minutes, so we're just kind of going to go through it real quick and execute it as administrator, just as the bad guy would. This is UAC. Okay, now you see it here. And then look what it dropped right away, IGFX TreyX. Okay? Now, this is the actual badness right here. This is what does all the wiping and all of the evil. But again, it's just in a sleep mode right now. So we're going to start up our timer. And we're going to get that going. Okay? And we're going to leave that running. All right. So with that said, let's switch on over to Cleaver and talk a little bit about that. Now, one of the cool ways to represent the data that we found on Operation Cleaver, which started, you could argue, 5 to 7 years ago, even though we've only been tracking it for the past two and a half years, is globally. So these were the victims globally around, focused in almost entirely on global critical infrastructure. So airports and airlines, oil and gas, energy and utilities, even car manufacture, heavy machinery, manufacturing, things of that nature. And it's a cool way to kind of represent it and show over time how these victims came online. And so you can see the scroll, the timeline bar down here. And of course, you can go to this cool little app that Brian put together and kind of watch it over time as well. All right. So let's talk about this real quick. As we said before, probably started around 2007, focused on global critical infrastructure. Initial compromise was the real phase, the first phase was how do we gain initial compromise as it normally is? Then how do we exfiltrate data and stay persistent? And then ultimately it was setting up for potential sabotage, in my belief. Either that or just pure negotiating genius by the Iranians as part of the nuclear pact discussions. Of course, emanating out of Iranian net blocks, which doesn't necessarily mean that they're Iranian by nature. So I'll talk to you a little bit about that. Talk about the teams that were a part of it, and then the hosting companies as well. But they all basically tracked back to two predominantly Iranian-focused teams that were going after infrastructure for whatever purposes we may never know. But here, so for example, Tar Andishan was one of the commonly labeled subnet blocks out there. And that was an engineering, an oil and gas engineering company in Tehran. They were focused exclusively on building oil and gas plants. And all of a sudden, they stopped being on the internet about 2010, 2011. So in other words, like their whole company just disappeared. And then we started to see it here in this campaign. So Tarnishan means innovators and inventors, and we had a ton of subnet blocks that were part of it. The Netafraz infrastructure was in Iran. They used Persian hacker names all over the place. But one of the coolest parts, and Brian's going to demo it in just a minute, is they actually built tools that would warn them if they were coming from Iran. So if they weren't coming from Iran, it would be green and, you know, good to go. And if they were coming from Iran, the sourcing IP address, and they hadn't anonymized their IP address yet, it would come up as red. So as you can see here, red and green. And tons of Persian inside of the binaries as well. There were some scan files with times stamps back to Iran as well. So a lot of that helped certainly triangulate the sourcing of it. The damage itself was mostly exfiltration. It was persistence. It was setting up for a future endeavor of some sort, but they were able to get darn near everything. Usernames and passwords of entire Active Directory trees, crew credentials for airline and airports. They were able to kind of go in and out on a couple of airports in the Middle East. They had complete network access of the infrastructure. And they even had stolen LastPass credentials, which I thought was kind of funny. I mean, sad and really funny at the exact same time. So all of us want to have, you know, easy passwords, or at least hardened, secure passwords. And of course, LastPass is one of the ways you do it, but they are cloud-based. And so the ability for the attackers to gain access to the master credentials of these organizations was present. Another reason why we felt like we needed to move fast. So at the end of the day, the Iranian capabilities definitely are improving. They're definitely evolving. They are or were going after critical infrastructure. The teams have by and large been somewhat dismantled. Of course, there are other teams, Iranian-backed, that are going after other targets. All right. So now let's talk about some of the details. And I'm just going to let Brian kind of take over and talk about how they actually got on the systems and how they worked. So let me switch you over.
Oops. All right.
Did I switch you?
It looks like it's tweaking out there.
Oh, there you go. You're up.
All right, cool. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of walk through a mock simulation, if you will, of an attack from the Tar Andishan, or the Zhao Pin threat actor responsible for Operation Cleaver. So the first thing I'm going to do is show winresume.com. This was a website they actually did clone, so they didn't use it in the way that I'm going to be using it here, but it is a website that was used during the campaign. And essentially what they did was they cloned the website to easyresumecreatorpro.com, and then they modified the download URL here, or they modified the actual setup.exe that is downloaded from that location. So as the attacker, we're going to now just nmap the system to kind of get a better idea of what's running. And this is a local version of the web server. I'm not live hacking this website. This takes a few seconds. There we go. So we can see that it's running a number of services. But most importantly, it's actually running anonymous FTP, which actually points right to the web directory. And this kind of makes it easy to move the demo along. It's a convenient vulnerability. So let's open FileZilla here. And we can see that we can log right into the FTP server right there. From here, we're going to jump into actually the tool that Stu was mentioning earlier that shows which contributes to the Iranian attribution. This tool is called Shell Creator 2. It's developed in .NET, and essentially it works in three components, where one component is the actual application which creates the ASPX web shell, and then there's the ASPX web shell, which is both encrypted as well as its communications are encrypted. And in order to interface with it, the attacker has to run a Java application locally, which then handles the sending of commands over the encrypted channel as well as receiving them. So we're going to start out by creating a web shell. And it's just going to ask for a key here, so I'm just going to do 123456 just for simplicity. And it actually writes it out to / out.aspx, so I'm just going to copy that. And now we're just going to upload it over FTP. And we can see that's there. So I'm going to run the local client. And let's say, for example, our attacker currently is connecting out of Iran. That's actually, I forget which IP that is, but I've set up a mock version of the GeoIP service that they use to connect out to. So I'm currently responding with Iran, so it's displaying in red, warning the user that they're,
What am I touching? What am I touching? It is Iran. They're in. Okay, there you go. We got them back. This is one of the coolest tools because it was really simple in the sense that, you could basically tunnel everything through the web server. Do whatever you want, shell out, kind of pull all kinds of information, and it sourced your sort. I mean, it told you where you're coming from, and if it was from Iran, it yelled at you. No,
I think it's the cable under here.
We're fine now.
So I'm just going to set, or I have set the address for the client here to winresume.com/out.aspx, pointing to the location of the uploaded web shell. And I'm just going to simply do a directory listing here. And very quickly, we can see results for it. And I'm just going to run over some of the other features here. We can load up the drive list to show all the information on the drive and kind of explore that around. We can also jump over to an information tab. So you can dump general information.
This because they'll tell you what antivirus is running, and you can try to shut it down, or
if we go
firewall
over,
is running.
Yeah, go over here. It shows the that it's running Microsoft Security Essentials, and it currently has no firewall.
All right.
we're actually going to close this now and move on to replacing the setup.exe on the web server. That way, a victim connecting in, trying to download it, downloads what the attackers want.
Yeah, because you can imagine the vector of attack, right? Sending an email out to a bunch of folks saying, hey, you know, you should, edit your resume and use our product to help edit your resume and find a free, you know, Win Resume Pro product to help you do that. And so you click on it, you download it, and sure enough, it's backdoored with something malicious in it.
Okay. So now we're going to jump over to our victim. Sorry for anyone who has epilepsy or
along
those lines. Okay.
Of course, this all worked many, many times beforehand, right? Yeah. Okay, keep going.
Okay, so just at the victim, I'm going to go up to winresume.com and just simply download the malicious application without checking.
So there were two ways to do this. The first one was simply send the link out and download this program. The other one was to actually prompt you to upload your resume. And they would typically domain squat something, like Northrop, you know, Grumman.net, something, some variant of it.
Okay.
And say, hey, we think your resume is great. We've seen you on LinkedIn, and we want you to, you know, submit your resume. And so you'd click on this link. The link would go to their upload or resume upload site. And of course, as you uploaded the resume, it really wouldn't upload any resume. It would download a malicious program, which of course ran and allowed you to gain access onto the system and be part of the botnet.
Yeah. I'm actually running the fake resume submitter right now. So it displays the information that you want to put in. So you can put in, you know, your name. I'm not going to fill all this out because I don't want to fill out a resume right now.
Yeah. So the victim would fill it all out and hit submit, and it would actually download badness.
So you hit submit, and then it actually just goes out, reaches to Microsoft.com, and doesn't actually submit anything, which I thought was particularly evil.
One of the initial vectors, they went after universities to gain access and kind of test out, I believe, a lot of their work, because you got a lot of click-throughs on that.
Now, if we look at the process list, we see, it's familiar to me, but generally unfamiliar, process called netscp.exe. And this is a name that they used very commonly for the malware called TinyZBot, not to be confused with Zeus or its variants. TinyZBot is developed in .NET, and it's primarily a rat gathering information, running commands, tasks like that. For this demo, I actually developed a command and control server for TinyZBot because I did not gather one during the investigation, and that's what we're looking at now is a command and control server here for TinyZBot, and we can see the victims all over the globe here plotted on Google Maps. And if we scroll down, we can see new bots. Oops, sorry. We can see new bots, which is the bot we just obtained, as well as previous bots. So we're waiting for the bot to upload its system information. While we're doing that, we're going to submit a few commands because it checks about every minute for new commands.
So you can imagine the bad guys kind of logging into this every day, kind of watching, you know, what new victims were there, and then kind of working each system to gain a foothold to pull information as needed, and to just learn and kind of to pivot inside and to get deeper and deeper access.
So the system information has filled out. And similar to the web show application, they're actually gathering information such as the anti-spyware, the antivirus, and the firewall running. And we can also see that the current user is NT Authority System, so it's thoroughly owned, the machine. And down here we can actually look at the commands we ran. So net accounts showing information about how it's configured to work on the network. And then I have a directory listing of C to kind of show, that I can list files. And then additionally, who am I again to do to show its NT Authority System.
Okay. So So that's kind of a quick and dirty version of Operation Cleaver and how they kind of worked. It was quite simple. Once, of course, they gained access in, they pivoted everywhere, and they just further got more and more control and more persistence. In the 88-page report goes through gory detail around every part of that campaign and talks about kind of the motivations potentially behind it. All right, so next what we want to show you is a couple of forever days. Now, if you haven't heard that term before, it's what we call things that are just never going to go away. They're not 0 days, you know, they're not 1 to 2 days, they're forever days. They're going to be here pretty much forever. If you were to call up the vendor, in this case it would be Microsoft, they would just say, yeah, this is a feature and, you know, we're not going to change it. So there it is. So I want to talk a little bit about what these are, and in particular, we kind of rediscovered and then kind of found a new way to exploit a forever day using SMB. So this is how it works. Basically, discovered in about 1997. I was working at InfoWorld at the time and building and writing the Security Watch column forever, and I came across this guy, Aaron Spangler. I think I was at the University of Washington. And he had discovered a way to actually just listen for requests from the IE browser itself for access to something that might be located on an SMB share, so a Windows share. Well, when there is a Windows share resource, Internet Explorer would actually submit the local credentials, so my credentials, my encrypted username and password, it would submit it over the internet to the website that's asking for it because it has a share, and in many cases, it doesn't even ask for it. And all he would do is he modified Samba at the time on Linux, and he would just listen to every request and just record it, username, encrypted password. And he would go back and try and crack them and see how easy it was to crack. And, of course, back then it was very, very simple. Even today it's quite trivial. And so, you know, we keep kicking around these forever days, and we just keep thinking, well, gosh, how could we spin this a different way, even though, you know, it's an age-old issue. And the difference in what we've been able to discover, what Brian discovered, is that you don't even need to send it a file directive of, hey, find this image on this SMB share now to kick out encrypted credentials from your Windows box. All you have to do is really listen to the network. So using functions that are inside of this particular DLL, we've discovered, Brian discovered, what, 31, 32?
So, yeah, at least 30 applications, but there's undoubtedly a very large number of additional applications using those four functions on the previous slide. And essentially what those functions allow for, which is really the core of this attack, is allowing for redirection from communications on HTTP and HTTPS to a file link, essentially jumping over to Samba, or as the actual attack's called, redirect to SMB.
Yeah, so this is not in any way, shape, or form an exhaustive list, right? This was what Brian could do in the wee hours of, you know, 10 p.m. to 3 a.m. when, you know, his second day job goes on with silence. And he was able to discover it in these things. So Adobe Reader, Internet Explorer, I'm sure you've heard of a few of these, right, apps? But even some AV vendors, right? It's pretty much universal. This is not just a 31 different applications problem. This is pretty much probably the vast majority of all Windows applications that have some communication outbound using any of those feature functionality, any of those DLLs and the functions inside the DLL. So hopefully that gives you a sense of how big this challenge could be. I mean, even box sync, right? I think Apple software update. So yeah. Does anybody use iTunes and update Apple iTunes on a Windows box or anything? Yeah, it'll submit your creds up. So we'll talk about the mitigation to it, but first we want to show it. So Brian's got a great demo. What's going to happen here is he's going to ARP poison, so it's just a man-in-the-middle, raw man-in-the-middle attack, presuming you're on the subnet domain, the broadcast domain for the subnet. But there is another way to do it, which is DNS poisoning. We're going to show you the ARP poisoning way. So we're going to ARP poison the victim box. All traffic is going to go from that victim box in and through us. And we're going to listen for the credentials as part of a natural update process. We're going to crack those creds, hopefully quickly. and then we'll reuse them to gain access and control of that victim system. Now, again, we haven't sent a single packet to this individual outside of an ARP update, right? That's it to get this level of access. Okay. So with that, I'll switch it back to you, Brian.
Okay. So I'm going to do some quick setup for this. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to launch smbtrap2.py. It's a SMB server I developed in Python just to assist with demos. There's additional applications that do the SMB authentication gathering, such as Metasploit. So it's not the only application out there. But that's going to sit in the background for a little bit. Additionally, I have Mitten proxy here, man-in-the-middle proxy. It's a cool tool which allows for running man-in-the-middle attacks on HTTP and HTTPS a whole lot simpler. And what we're using here is actually an inline script, which is going to handle the actual redirection from HTTP to SMB. And it's just going to simply return a 302 response, which just says, hey, resource isn't here anymore, and then it supplies a URL where to check next. So I'm going to launch that. And we'll get back to that. And next here, we have a tool called ZARP, which is going to handle the man-in-the-middle attack. But first, we're going to do a port redirect from port 80 to 8080, because Mitten proxy is listening on 8080. And now we're going to go do the ARP spoofing. So this is the IP of the network gateway for the virtual network that these are all on right now. And let's get the IP of the victim here.
Yeah, so just to be clear, I mean, man-in-the-middle attacks are pretty simple. It just basically says, hey, instead of sending all your traffic outbound to through the router, send it to me first, because I'm your new router, and then I'm going to forward it off.
Okay, so now we're going to jump over to the victim, and we're this victim's noticed weird things on their network recently. So what they're going to do is they're going to run a Microsoft Baseline Security Analyzer, reasonable thing to do, and they're going to run it on their network gateway. They could run it on any other PI on the network, but. So when this scan starts, it attempts to download a security update from Microsoft.com, and it has already failed to do so. And look, an unexpected error has occurred. And this error has resulted in, so this is, again, Mitten proxy to display in there. We can see that the HTTP requests were intercepted and then supplied with a 302 status code there, indicating that they need to be redirected. And if we look over in SMB trap, we can see that it did so successfully. And SMB trap has a very small, simple hash cracker built into it in order to crack quick passwords. And in this case, we're looking at a password of Nesha Nesha 12, which is actually a password we saw used by the Operation Cleaver attackers on multiple occasions.
Yeah. So quite lazy, but it's usually more typical than not.
So now we're going to use a tool. It's called WinExe, but it's pretty much a Linux version of PSExec. I want to use those credentials to log in. It's forward slash. Backslash.
So we've been able to actually get the encrypted credentials, been able to crack it, those passwords, or the password that we got from the victim. And now we're resubmitting it to gain command prompt access onto the system.
I'm just going to actually run cmd.exe. And
here we go.
That's, where did I screw up?
Log on failure. Is it percent?
I'm not sure where I screwed up here.
All right. Well, you figure that out. We'll get back to that. All right, so let's go ahead and switch back over. That's the final step, of course, in demo guide.
I figured it out, sorry.
You know what you did?
Yeah.
Wrong. Yeah. Okay.
There we go.
Oh, there we go.
And who am I? John.victim. Okay.
There you go. Beautiful. So now, yeah, you got complete access onto the box and can do whatever you want on that victim system, all because it was trying to send out its credentials out over the wire. So you could literally just listen to this type of activity all the while. Okay, cool. Thank you, Brian. Mm-hmm. All right. So next, we want to show another forever day. Again, this is, you call up Microsoft, they'll say the exact same thing they did with the SMB one. And we're calling it Shame on UAC because it's just so easy. So you know what UAC is, of course. When you try and get administrative credential or run a process as an administrator, it needs to prompt you. And that, you know, happened, what, after XP? You know, too much exploitation without having any kind of prompting for administrator-level access. And so normally you go into something and it prompts you, and you know exactly what's going to happen. You're going to hit yes, and the registry editor is going to pop up, or a command prompt will pop up, or something will run. But we've been able to figure out a way to, instead of just have that particular program run, we can run whatever we want to run. We can run anything else on the system, all by basically backdooring UAC. Okay?
It's actually done through a fairly simple hooking mechanism. So in the normal UAC escalation process, the admin opens registryedit.exe. And during that process, the function AIC launch is called. And it's called in explorer.exe. And with, it contains the arguments of regedit with no arguments. So it's a normal regedit call. And then the user gets displayed a consent.exe, which is actually running a system, requesting that the user agree that, yes, I want to elevate. Now with the Shame on UAC attack, the attacker launches an application which essentially creates a hook of the AIC launch function in explorer.exe. So when the AIC launch function in explorer gets called, the registry edit call itself is then modified. So the attacker is able to, in this situation, replace regedit with anything they want. They can insert any arguments they want. For this demo, we're actually going to be adding on a /s to silently process a .reg file in order to modify registry keys automatically by appending /s attack.reg. And when the UAC prompt is then opened, it still shows that it's registry editor. And you can only see the detail that of the actual attack itself if you go in and hit show details, which is by default hidden. So the actual registry file, when it's first processed, it will modify appinit DLL in the registry to force shame on UAC to be loaded every time a new executable is run. And this happens because the user allows for this to happen. They click yes, and that escalation happens, so the registry is then modified. But the hook of AIC launch is not quite done yet. What it does after this, then, is it attempts to reopen registry edit so that the user can see it. So normally, this would then display another UAC prompt, but since the UAC prompt is then loading the appinit DLL, our DLL, we're able to suppress it and then force our payload to then execute.
Okay. So enough of the prep. There you go. Yeah. All right. There we go.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. You just got to wiggle it. That's a magic touch.
And just for simplicity, I'm just going to I have a dropper application here. It's going to drop a few tools, but it's also going to drop the injection DLL as well as the injector application, and it's going to run it. So the actual attack is going to be very simple right here. I'm just going to double-click as non-privileged, and it's run. Yeah.
And so if you're a forensic investigator or an incident responder or something of that nature, obviously this is somewhat unique, right? It hasn't really been talked about in many circles at all. But being able to look for this obviously should be a part of the investigation, without a doubt, and added to the toolkit, if you will. Getting no love? Okay, there we go.
All right, now I'm going to click Run as Administrator. Now we get the normal UAC prompt here. And that was just the normal registry edit.exe, found it through search.
Yeah.
And it's unmodified on disk. But when we click Show Details, we can see that it's loading /S from...
Right, and how many of you have actually showed details, all right, when you... Or, you know, typical users are never going to look into this. But if you did, you could see that there was something funky there, that /S, with a new command of any sort, and we've got it in the temporary directory. And so now if you hit yes.
The registry prompt just kind of pops up as it would normally, completely, almost completely invisibly to the user that this attack has gone on. And actually, if we look at netstat here, we can see that, look at that, there's now a process running that's listening on port 4444. And in this case, it happens to be netcat. So let's log in there.
So all we did as a backdoor is simply run netcat on the listener 4444, and so we're going to go in and be able to gain access onto the system, hopefully. All works out.
Yep.
There we go. Boom.
And who am I? I am system. And then from here, we can, of course, launch other tools and other attacks. Let that not work.
Yeah, term emulation doesn't work too well in netcat these days.
So this is a group of tools that I dropped. So we're actually just going to run Mimikatz to dump... I did it again. Dump all the cache credentials here.
So Mimikatz, of course, dumps your passwords, so we can look at them either unencrypted or in the NTLM format. And there you have your user and victim.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, great. Fun stuff. So, again, just running that simple little backdoor program then maintains persistence that every single time anything is run by UAC, you're able to get any program to run that you want. In this case, we just dumped cache credentials, and of course you can connect back, and pretty much the game is over at that point. So that's the key, obviously, is trying to prevent it. The problem is there's nothing really outside of preventing the initial exploitation of that dropped malware to really stop this. It is a feature. It's not going to be fixed anytime soon. All right, so we're coming up on 33 minutes or so. So we're a little shy of 45 waiting for stuff. So I am getting a little impatient. As for those of you who know me, I get impatient in terms of running this bad stuff. So what I have is another VM that actually... is bypassing the sleep commands so that it'll just run instantly or within a few seconds or so. And this is the same sample, and what we've done is used caffeine to kind of modify all the sleep times on a Windows box to hard code them to, I believe it was 7 seconds. So what we're going to do is I'm going to run the same exact sample, and as you can see here, I've got all of my programs here, and I'm going to run this. First off, we got to make it live.
And just for some background on caffeine is pretty much injecting itself into every process via app-init DLLs and replacing calls to sleep with shorter sleeps.
Exactly, yep. Just replacing it all. It's almost like a binary editor, you know, if you could binary edit, you know, memory and the functions, that this is what it would do. So we're going to run this as administrator. Hit yes. Show processes from all users. Okay, you see the original malware. You see the IGFX tray. You see a few more dropped here. And if all goes well, okay, there it goes. So this is what any victim, Sony or otherwise, would have found that morning when they logged in. You go in, and as you can see, everything's starting to get wiped. Okay, so there's no more access to any of your programs or files. It does take a while to kill, of course, what is it, 16 or 9, yeah, whatever, 15 gigs of disk space. So it does take a little bit of time. But eventually, you'll get the display, the screen of death display. I'll just minimize this, kind of wait for the fun. Now, while that's happening, okay, what I want to do is I want to go over to a system where I have a little something called Sounds Protect, and what I'll do is take that same sample, and I'm going to drop it in here and execute it straight away. If I can get it to it fast enough, I'm going to try and execute it and see what happens. Okay, so we're going to execute it as, oh shoot, hold on a second, shoot. Okay, hold on a second, sorry. Boom. Okay, so here we go. Sounds Protect. It already got to it, darn it. But we're going to try and run it anyway. Yes, and boom. Of course, prevents it. Not because it's something new, it's because it's mathematically determined to be bad. We've been able to crack that code with the technology now. So, and then going back onto my system, not quite yet there, waiting for my screen of death, but it'll come up and it'll be completely hosed and you'll have to reboot. Now, just to prove this to you, let's go ahead and I'm gonna reboot this box. So you come in, you can't really do anything, the system's pretty much dead. Let's go ahead and reboot it and let's see what happens. Okay. So what the main wiper program did was it actually overwrote raw disk sector 0 and beyond, right? So what you get now is an unbootable system, and that's what they were met with. Okay, whenever they logged in, they see the screen of death, which I got too impatient to show you, let run, but then you reboot it, and sure enough, boom, you have no access into that particular image. Okay. All right. So what we saw, of course, with this attack was the gloom and doom skeleton, as we saw in a couple of prior attacks. What we do want to talk about, though, for the last couple minutes is the potential for another vector of entry that I think is important to mention with everybody. You haven't heard about it in the public domain yet, but we have we've been able to isolate and identify a potential additional vector inside of the company itself. So first off, they had been impacted dramatically by spear phishing attempts, at least for the last year or two, in trying to get their users to click on things. We've been able to identify a pretty advanced one that did credential harvesting, which could have easily allowed for remote access via VPN or ADP or anything, and then launch with harvested credentials. So when you look at some of the emails that they were getting, you certainly saw tons of, you know, the standard spear phishing attempts, but then you also saw a fancy one, which was this one. So Apple user ID verification. And it came from a domain called iOS Care Team, or if you read it really quickly, it's IO Scare Team. Right? And September 18th, 2014, I think I got to zoom in. Yeah, there we go. Okay, very interesting date and time. So now let's go back to the history on iOSScareTeam.com and .net. They had them both. They post action on it. So in 9/11, they posted that IP address for the resolution. And in 10/2, they removed it. Okay, so they had a window of about 3 weeks where a bulk of this activity was occurring, which would have easily given them the initial entry in to gain access. Now, what they were met with when they clicked on this link, system administrators, executives alike, was a very sophisticated, at least by spear phishing standards, front end. There, you try and submit your username and password, and of course it wouldn't work, but it would also come up in your locale ID in terms of the language that you're coming from. In this case, it was from Japan. Of course, once you get those credentials, a lot of password reuse occurs, or targeting of home systems, etc. But you could get on via VPN or RDP or remote mail. And the first-hand accounts of folks that I knew inside there, they were telling us, look, we're totally down. Someone on the IT team screwed up and ran something wrong. That was the first one I got. The other one was some people think it was someone from the inside, so like an insider threat. And that's where you got a lot of the rumor mill starting. But when you start to look at some of the data, what you realized was that there was clear indication that some very sensitive system administrators, including SCCM administrators, were actually a part of it. That made it perfect sense. It would look like an insider. It would look like it was pushed and distributed in. If you gained keys to that kingdom of the software distribution system, the big fix or whatnot, I mean, being able to destroy thousands of computers is pretty much instantaneous and without much effort whatsoever. Easy distribution to everything, and it would take a long, long time to go. So the two main threads, I already showed you the first thread, which is the raw disk writer capability of Wiper. The credentials that were built in that for distribution along the network side were here and widely publicized, but the C. Monty user was of particular interest because of his association. So now we're almost at 45 minutes. I know I'm over time, so we're going to cancel it here in just a second. But let's just do one last check, and let's see if we've got what we've got. All right, well, it will not pop for me. So with that, I'm going to just walk through some mitigations. Of course, protect your endpoint, successful auditing of domain administrator logins, and failure auditing of all logins. Take a look at this one. Actually, it's pretty cool. It's an event log, a system log event that you can look for that catches kernel mode driver service creations called Service Control Manager event 7045, prevent remote service creation. Use, of course, as many updates as you can. Protect your passwords. It's like so key between KeePass, LastPass, and everything else. We don't have time for bonus demo, so please come by the booth for us or come to the Children's Creativity Museum tonight for a party. For future resources, you can go check us out on YouTube, Twitter, Hacking Exposed. Of course, come by tonight and love to give you all the demos you want. Thanks again, everybody. Appreciate you coming.